today with Matty the Assassin Askin. How are you doing today, Matty? Are you okay?
Yeah, feeling really good, thanks.
You've got a big fight coming up next weekend against John Lewis Dickenson, British title eliminator for the Cruiserweight. So how do you feel about that?
I feel really good. I think it's a sort of fight that I need at this moment in time. During my career, you know, I've had 13 fights against reasonable opponents. I think it's about time to step up now. This fight's going to show that.
And what do you make of Dickenson as a fighter? He's a talented lad. He went off the boil a little bit, had two defeats, retired in one of them with a broken nose, and he's had jaw injuries. What have you made of him?
He's awkward. That's the only problem with him, throws his shots going backwards, you know, big looping shots. But he is good, and he's one of the best out there, you know, so it's going to be a good fight. I think the injuries will, you know, take an effect, in especially against someone like me, who is known as a big puncher.
And against Richard Tabor, he broke his jaw, retired in three. He then had to campaign to get his license back from the British Board of Control. Do you think the injury will be something that will be in the back of his mind?
Yeah, it's going to be, isn't it? It's already been brought once. Like I say, being in there with someone like me, he's going to be very, very scared about getting caught, you know, early on, if not late on in the fight. I think it will show an effect during the fight.
He's also, a former ABA titlist. He won the 2007 Cruiserweight Championship. Do you think his amateur pedigree is something that propelled him through the early days of his pro career?
Yeah, he's not changed much, I don't think, from when you watch him as an amateur to what he does now. I think he just throws a lot more punches and digs his feet to the canvas and shows a bit more power. But we both had the same sort of pedigree, you know, from the amateurs through to the pros. So, you know, on paper we're very evenly matched, but I'm going to show that I'm a better boxer.
And people have mentioned the fact he beat James DeGale in the junior ABAs. Do people pay attention to that, or do you see that as something that's in the past?
It's something that's in the past, you know, it's irrelevant really. Anything, them factors mean nothing. He's got 10 free minutes with, you know, who a lot of people consider as one of the best cruiserweights in Britain, and that for me doesn't mean anything.
He's also outpointed David Dolan, and he stopped Chris Burton. They're decent opponents with a lot of experience. Did you take anything away from those?
Yeah, you know, Dolan's a very tough fighter, comes forward, a pressure fighter, but you know, he's not the smartest of boxers, you know, he fights one way and one way only, very one-paced, you know, but he did, for how many fights he's had and where the level that Dolan's been at, he boxed really well. The Burton one, you couldn't really see much from it. You know, going on the two rounds and hurting him early on, you know, it didn't show a lot what Dickenson can do, but, you know, I'm going to make him throw punches and make mistakes.
It's a big step up for you. You've been the six round distance three times. One of them, you stopped the opponent in the sixth round. Do you think you can go to the 8 and 10 rounds? Do you think you can go through those
games? Yeah, without a shadow of a doubt. You know, since being with Bob, I'm a lot more fit than I've ever been in my career. Sparring, been doing a lot of rounds in sparring, you know, and getting stronger and stronger as each round go on. You know, I know every fighter says that, but I'm generally telling the truth, and you know, I can only show you on Saturday night.
And you succeeded Dickenson as the ABA winner in 2008. What was it like when you won that ABA title?
I was fortunate. You know, I went out in the semi, in the quarterfinals. You know, I was very unfortunate. I did go out. You know, a lot of people do think I won it, but it's one of the things. I got a call back the next day to fight one of the favourites. I was in there the next day, stopped him, and then went in to fight another one of the favourites in Ricky Newlands down in London. And I was fortunate again to get that opportunity, and I just took it with both hands.
And what's it do for winning an ABA? Do the promoters immediately start phoning through to you the next day?
No, you know, I just had a word with the trainers and told them what I wanted to do. You know, I wanted to get my England vest, and I wanted to, you know, have quite a decent and long amateur career, but it just never happened. And so, you know, I got in touch with a family friend, and he told me where to go and just try out a professional gym, and I just loved the way they trained, and it suited me, so I just turned over.
You turned over against Paul Bonson. I remember seeing some of your early fights. You were kind of a skitty fighter. You tended to do a bit of moving. Have you settled down a bit more in recent times?
When I first turned pro, I was never able to make 12-7, but I was just a lot smaller than every cruiserweight that I got in with. You know, very tall, thin. I was only 19 years old, and you know, the strength was a lot to take if I was in close fighting. You know, but now as I've developed, you know, and changed my style and the way I box, I've started to dig my feet a lot more, and you know, and my strength starts to come through now.
And do you think that's shown in recent results? After you passed six, you've stopped five. Do you think that's a sign that your strength's coming through?
Yeah, I wouldn't say I'm a massive puncher. I'm just, you know, for the size of me, I'm fast. And I do hit very accurate, you know. It's very rare that you'll see me miss or throw really wild shots. Just I'm a lot smarter now.
And you said when you fought Neil Dawson for the vacant Central Area Cruiserweight title, that was the toughest fight of your career so far. Is that because he was so rangy and it was difficult to pin him down?
Yeah, I think he's about 6'6", Dawson, you know, and I'm used to fighting people that were smaller than me. And, you know, I didn't really train for the fight without making an excuse. I shouldn't have really gone into the fight, but, you know, I'm very proud man, and, you know, don't like letting people down. But he was picking me off with his jab and I just couldn't seem to get past it whatsoever, and I just couldn't figure it out during the fight, and instead I just had to, you know, just dig deep and just, you know, just give it everything I had.
And your past five opponents have had more wins than they've had losses. Do you find guys like that come with a lot more confidence than the journeymen who come to just close up shop?
Yeah, there's nothing worse when you're getting with a boxer like when you catch him straight away and then that's it, and you can never tag him again all the way through the fight. And, you know, it's not an interesting fight, no one wants to watch them really, but they learn you and what you need to do to get on, you know, to bigger opponents. But I've always got better as the opponents have got better, you know. When they throw shots, that's when I can make them pay, you know. They leave gaps, leave openings, and that's what I do, I take on them openings.
And you worked with Brian Hughes' gym earlier in your career. Recently you came over to Bob Shannon. When did you join Bob, and when did you know that he was the guy you wanted to move forward with?
You know, Brian was considering retiring. You know, my last few fights hadn't gone well under Brian. I was very unfit, very flabby, but I was still taking fights, you know. But I sat down with my family, and my dad has always liked Bob, even when we've watched him at shows. You know, you just have to look at his fighters, they're all in great condition, they're all fit. And, you know, Bob's a very good technician as well as a great conditioner. And I met him in June last year. You know, at Ricky Hatton's gym, I had a chat with him, I did a bit of work with him, and straight away he noticed about four or five things I was doing wrong. And then, you know, we just gelled straight away, and I just love everything that he's done for me and done with me so far.
And you went, your first fight, I believe, was the Jan Manuel Garay fight, was that the first fight with him? Did you feel comfortable with him in the corner straight away on the night?
Yeah, I felt really comfortable, you know. It was a different feeling because I've been with Brian, and, you know, they do obviously different chains have different ways of doing things, and being with Bob it was like I'd just turned pro again. I was fighting back in Blackpool, the nerves were there, you know, and then having my hands wrapped differently and the way the changing room, the atmosphere is different, and it was just so nerve wracking. But once I was in there and I started listening to him in the third and fourth round, you know, I started feeling comfortable and I got Garay out of there.
And Bob does a lot of work on footwork, I believe, with the lads as well. He has you moving around a lot. Is that a big help to work on the fundamentals as well?
Yeah, you know, he's pretty much stripped me back down. I've always had a good basic, you know, a good jab, a good right hand. But he's got me now where I can balance on both feet, you know, throwing different various shots. You know, and he does work a lot on the fundamentals, which you don't see a lot when people think he's a great conditioning coach, but he's not, he's a very good technical coach as well.
And does the fact that he's taken fighters through British, European title fights give you confidence when you go back to the corner knowing he has the experience of guiding guys through tough periods?
Oh, definitely, you know, he's very calm as well, which is good. He's not someone that's frantic and screaming at you when you're in the corner, but he knows what he's talking about, you know, and you've got to trust in him, and I wouldn't be with him if I didn't think I could trust in everything he says.
And you're fighting out Blackpool, it's coming up at the minute, Blackpool, you've got Brian Rolls, he's a British light middleweight champion. Is it nice to be part of a boxing community that's starting to come to the forefront?
Yeah, Blackpool's booming now, like you say. Brian's just had his first defence of his British light middleweight title, which is a great fight, everyone buzzing around him at the minute. There's me now on the fringes of getting a British title fight. Jack Arnfield's back, and we've got great talent as well in Scott Cardell and Adam Little. You know, Blackpool's a real hotbed now for boxing.
And are the fans taken to you? Do you get recognised on the streets around Blackpool?
Yeah, we do get recognised. But you know, it's really good. The fans in Blackpool are amazing. You know, they love the boxing as well. I mean, every show I've been to in Blackpool's in an absolute sellout, and that's even the amateur shows as well.
And last time we talked, you mentioned that you, one of your heroes is Rocky Marciano. Fighters tend to go for the likes of Floyd Mayweather, Sugar Ray Leonard. What is it about Marciano that stands out?
I just love his determination and his grit, you know, the way he fights. You just know when he's in there, he isn't going to get beat. He'll do everything and anything to win, and that's the mentality I like to take into my fights, where, you know, you've got to dig deep. And he wasn't the best technician or the best boxer, but he was just so gritty and determined, and, you know, you knew that when he was in, going to get in there, there was just no one that could match him for that.
And I believe you and Bob have spoken about taking a trip over to Germany. There's a lot of cruiserweights over there for you to spar. Is that something you'd like to do over the next year?
I think it's something I need to do to take me to the next level. You know, we have talked about it, and after this fight, I think this is what we're going to have to do. We have to go over to Germany and have a look at these top cruiserweights in the world, and, you know, get in there and just get my name about, and, you know, learn from their experiences.
But it's something Bob's done before with his other fighters. He's taken them around the world for the sparring. Do you think that's something that'll help develop you in some ways more than the fights you've already had?
Yeah, of course. I mean, the fights I've already had now, I've not won, you know, easy, but they've not really been a massive test for me and where I need to be. And, you know, going over there, it's going to be like having a tremendous British fight over there, you know, just even with the spars out there.
And I believe also one of your dreams is to fight in Las Vegas. Is that just a general fighter's dream?
Yeah, of course it is. You know, when it's where all the main boxing heroes go when they fought, haven't they? And I think we just love to see naming lights.
And you got into the sport relatively late, at the age of 16. What kept it so long for you before getting into boxing?
I played football when I was a young lad. I played for Blackburn, I had scouts for Liverpool, I played for Blackpool, and just before I actually got back into boxing, I played for Scunthorpe. And you know, I was doing kickboxing as well at the time. My little brother was a dual world kickboxing champion, and I just could never do it, I could never kick my legs, and my dad said, why don't you just try going back to boxing and, you know, just keep fit. I had a couple of fights, and, you know, I just got it in my head that this is could be easy money.
Hey, that's it, yeah. Keep going all the way.
Recently, Enzo Maccarinelli's won the British Cruiserweight title against Matt Philbin. Shane is a tough guy, former British titlist himself. If Enzo does vacate the title, would you like to go in against Shane McPhilbin for the vacant belt?
Yeah, I'd fight anyone. Like I say, it's getting, it feels like every time I get a step close, it just gets a step further away from me. But, you know, I'll fight anyone and everyone. It doesn't really make a difference to me. You know, I feel like I am the best in Britain, and I think I'm proving that now with the way I'm stopping my opponents. But yeah, if that fight has to come off, then albeit, I'm more than willing to jump in with Shane.
And what did you make of Shane and Enzo's recent performance?
It wasn't the best of British fights, to be honest with you. It wasn't a great spectacle to watch. You know, come next Saturday, you're going to watch two of the best cruiserweights in Britain having a proper fight, but just for the lesser belt of the English title.
Right, cheers, man.
No problem. Yeah.